All right, so today I'm going to explain you on Von Goetz disease. Von Goetz disease is a type 1 glycogen storage disorders. So glycogen storage disorders, in fact, we have 8 of them. So we have Von Goetz disease, we have Pompe's disease, we have Corey's disease, Anderson's disease, then we have McArdle syndrome, Hirsch syndrome, then we have Tarui's disease. In that very first one, type 1 glycogen storage disease is Von Goetz disease. So Von Goetz disease, it has got two types, type 1A and 1B. Type 1A is because of deficiency of glucose 6-phosphatase. This glucose 6-phosphatase is an endoplasmic reticulum located enzyme. And type 1B Von Goetz disease is because of a defect or a mutation in T1 transporter. And this T1 transporter is helping in the transport of glucose 6-phosphate into the endoplasmic reticulum to be converted into glucose by glucose 6-phosphatase, which is located there. Okay, let's talk about type 1A and then I'll explain you 1B. Okay, so type 1A, as I said, it is because of deficiency of glucose 6-phosphatase. What this enzyme does, it's going to convert glucose 6-phosphate, into glucose. This is a simple job it does. What it does, it's going to release inorganic phosphate and convert glucose 6-phosphate into glucose molecule. Okay, and this particular enzyme is located in the endoplasmic reticulum. Okay. What happens if there is a deficiency of glucose 6-phosphatase enzyme? So this enzyme is down. Okay, because of this, what happens? There will be rise in glucose 6-phosphate. There will be increase in glucose 6-phosphate. This glucose 6-phosphate builds up. Okay, because of this, what happens? So the glucose 6-phosphate has got different options here now. Glucose 6-phosphate can go into glycogen formation. Glycogen. Why? Because, and also note that glucose 6-phosphatase enzyme is located in the liver and kidney. These are the common locations for glucose 6-phosphatase, endoplasmic reticulum of liver and kidney as glucose 6-phosphatase. Now that enzyme is down, which is leading to Von Goetz disease. Okay, and that is type 1A. Type 1A Von Goetz disease is because of glucose 6-phosphatase enzyme itself is down. Okay, so glucose 6-phosphate accumulates. This glucose 6-phosphate, it is going to stimulate glycogen synthase enzyme. Glucose 6-phosphate has got a positive effect on glycogen synthase enzyme, positively modulated. It means it will lead to accumulation of glycogen in the liver. Glycogen is accumulated in the liver and kidney accumulates glycogen, and that is why you see hepatomegaly and renomegaly. Hepatomegaly and renomegaly commonly seen in Von Goetz disease because of the deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate. Okay, that's one option for glucose 6-phosphate. Now the glucose 6-phosphate can run down into glycolysis and will form pyruvate. Glucose 6-phosphate will form pyruvate. In the glycolysis, it forms pyruvate. Now pyruvate gets into the mitochondria. As you all know, one of the fate of pyruvate is mitochondria. Pyruvate gets down into the mitochondria and form acetyl-CoA. That's one of the fate of pyruvate. So excess glucose 6-phosphate means excess pyruvate will form excess acetyl-CoA. Initially acetyl-CoA gets into TCA cycle and completely burned down into carbon dioxide. You all know product of TCA cycle, end product of TCA cycle is carbon dioxide there. Okay, now when there is too much of acetyl-CoA, as you all know, acetyl-CoA will have a negative effect on pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. So when acetyl CoA builds up, acetyl CoA will have a negative effect on PDC, pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Because of this, what happens? Pyruvate builds up. And this pyruvate is now diverted towards lactate formation. Lactate builds up. There is increase in the lactate, and this will lead to lactic acidosis. Lactic acidosis. That is why in Wangert's disease you can see lactic acidosis. In Wangert's disease you see fasting hypoglycemia. Why do you see fasting hypoglycemia? Because under fasting condition, glycogen is broken down into glucose 1 phosphate, then into glucose 6 phosphate. Glucose 6 phosphate is converted to glucose by glucose 6 phosphatase. Since glucose 6 phosphatase is down here, there is increase in glucose 6 phosphate. In the same time, there will be decrease in glucose. And that is why you see fasting hypoglycemia. Fasting hypoglycemia in Wangert's disease. You see lactic acidosis in Wangert's disease. That's because pyruvate increases, diverted towards lactate formation. Now let's see what else will happen here. So now, as we have seen, more and more pyruvate going down here, forming acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA getting into TCA cycle initially. TCA cycle is saturating. Acetyl-CoA builds up, have a negative effect on PDC. So that is what is shown here. So acetyl-CoA will have a negative effect on pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Now there is a reason for why acetyl-CoA builds up so much. Okay, buildup of acetyl-CoA, one of the reason for that is whenever there is a fasting hypoglycemia here, because of that hypoglycemia, glucagon is released. Glucagon. What this glucagon does? Glucagon will stimulate adipose tissue lipolysis. Lipolysis, and it means triacylglycerol is broken down into fatty acids and glycerol. Fatty acids and glycerol. These fatty acids will be brought into the mitochondria. Fatty acids are brought into the mitochondria of hepatocytes and undergo beta oxidation process will go on. And that will release acetyl-CoA. Fatty acid oxidation product is acetyl-CoA, and that's why you see buildup of acetyl-CoA, increase in acetyl-CoA. Okay. Now when this acetyl-CoA increases, acetyl-CoA is an energy-rich molecule. Each acetyl-CoA it is worth 12 ATPs. We don't want to waste this acetyl-CoA. So acetyl-CoA within the mitochondria are converted to ketones. Ketones by ketone body synthesis. So it means ketones will increase accordingly, and these ketones will appear in the blood now. Ketones in blood. So ketone body will increase in the blood, and the ketone bodies are basically, they are acetoacetate and beta hydroxybutyrate. These are the acidic molecules, acetoacetate and beta hydroxybutyrate. That's why increasing ketone bodies will lead to ketoacidosis. Ketoacidosis. Increasing ketone bodies will lead to ketoacidosis. Okay. Now let's see what else can happen. So buildup of glucose 6 phosphate, forming glycogen. Glycogen accumulates, leading to hepatomegaly, renomegaly. Glucose 6 phosphate going into glycolysis. This is glycolysis, forming pyruvate, excess pyruvate going into initially into mitochondria, increasing acetyl-CoA, and the TCA cycle saturate, when acetyl-CoA builds up, PDC is decreased, and this PDC activity when it decreases, it raises pyruvate, pyruvate can go into lactate formation. Okay, so, and also you have hypoglycemia in Wangert's disease. Hypoglycemia leads to increase in glucagon, and the increase in glucagon forms adipose tissue lipolysis, releasing fatty acid and bringing acetyl-CoA here. Okay, so acetyl-CoA is diverted into ketone bodies, and there will be ketoacidosis. Now, glucose 6-phosphate, other fate of glucose 6-phosphate is it can go into pentose phosphate pathway. Pentose phosphate pathway. One of the product of pentose phosphate pathway is you are going to get NADPH, NADPH plus H plus, NADPH plus H plus, and also you are going to get ribose 5 phosphate. NADPH plus H plus and ribose 5 phosphate. Now, especially if the person is in well-fed condition, say all the Von Willebrand disease signs and symptoms, especially the adipose tissue lipolysis, fasting hypoglycemia, all this you are going to see when the person gets into fasting condition. If the person is in well-fed condition at that time, and also when you are not breaking down glucose 6-phosphate into glucose, especially when you don't need it, so the glucose 6-phosphate is diverted here into NADPH formation and ribose 5 phosphate formation, and the ribose 5 phosphate will form PRPP, that is phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate, and this phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate will be diverted into purines and pyrimidine synthesis. Purines and pyrimidines. When there is excess purines and pyrimidines are formed, so the purines and pyrimidines will undergo degradation. Okay, and the degradation product of purines is uric acid. Uric acid, and degradation product of pyrimidines is carbon dioxide and ammonia. No problem with the carbon dioxide ammonia, although ammonia can increase a little bit, leading to hyperammonemia. But the uric acid, it can build up. Why uric acid builds up? There is a reason for this. One is excess uric acid formation. Other is, there is a lactic acidosis here. Always note that in the renal tubular cells, lactic acid will compete with uric acid for secretory mechanism in the renal tubular cells. So when there is more lactic acid, less uric acid is getting chance to get into the urine so that it is excreted. So it means because of the lactic acidosis, uric acid is not getting chance in a secretory mechanism which is competitive. So uric acid tends to build up, and this can lead to hyperuricemia. Hyperuricemia, and this hyperuricemia can lead to gout. Excess uric acid can lead to signs and symptoms of gout. That's why in Von Willebrand disease you may see hyperuricemia and leading to gout. Okay, so that's about ribose 5 phosphate going towards hyperuricemia. Now let's see what is the use of NADPH plus H plus. If there is plenty of NADPH plus H plus, this NADPH plus H plus will be diverted towards fatty acid synthesis, and also it is diverted towards cholesterol synthesis. Now, how fatty acid synthesis and cholesterol synthesis can go on in Von Willebrand disease patients? As you can see here, initially pyruvate is going into acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA saturates the TCA cycle. When the TCA cycle is saturated, so the citrate, which is one of the intermediate of TCA cycle, the citrate can move out of mitochondria. Let me use different color. Citrate can move out of mitochondria into the cytoplasm. And bringing that here because I have a space here to write. So, citrate, which is there in the cytoplasm, will be broken down into acetyl-CoA, and this acetyl-CoA will go into fatty acids formation, and also it will go into cholesterol formation, fatty acid and cholesterol formation. So in more and more fatty acids and cholesterol synthesized, so these fatty acids can be binding to glycerol 3-phosphate to form triacylglycerol. So there will be more triacylglycerol, there will be increase in triacylglycerol, and acetyl-CoA going into cholesterol, so there will be increase in cholesterol. That is why in Von Willebrand disease patient, there will be hyper triacylglycerolemia, means excess triacylglycerol in the blood, and also hypercholesterolemia. So all these are the signs that you are going to see in type 1A von Goetz disease. So let me revise all of them. You have hepatomegaly, renomegaly because accumulation of glycogen. You have lactic acidosis. Patient will have lactic acidosis. Patient will have fasting hypoglycemia. Patient will have ketoacidosis. Patient will have hyperuricemia and gout signs and symptoms. And the patient will have hypertriglyceridemia and hypercholesterolemia. All of them you are going to see because of decrease in the activity of glucose 6-phosphatase. That is type 1A. Type 1B. Type 1B, additional signs in type 1B is you are going to see neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction. And the cause for type 1B is mutation in T1 transporter. Okay, where do you need T1 transporter? Here is the endoplasmic reticulum. As I said, glucose 6-phosphatase is in the endoplasmic reticulum. It means glucose 6-phosphate, which is there in the cytoplasm, it has to enter into the lumen of the endoplasmic reticulum. And for that, you need a T1 transporter here. For glucose 6-phosphate to get into the endoplasmic reticulum. Once it gets in there, you have glucose 6-phosphatase, converts glucose 6-phosphate into glucose and inorganic phosphate. And glucose is coming out of endoplasmic reticulum through T3 transporter, and inorganic phosphate uses T2 transporter. So these are the transporter. T1 transporter for glucose 6-phosphate, T2 transporter for inorganic phosphate, T3 transporter for glucose. All of them are in the endoplasmic reticular membrane. Now, if there is a mutation in T1 transporter, it means glucose 6-phosphate is not getting into endoplasmic reticulum. That means glucose 6-phosphate accumulates, and all these signs you are going to see there in T1 transporter mutation. Along with that, what else you are going to see is there will be neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction. Because of the neutropenia, what happens, there will be increase in chances of infection because neutrophils, they fight against bacteria, and also there will be increased risk of bleeding. Okay, so the neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction. What is the exact, why there is a neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction in type 1B von Goetz disease? It is not clear. Exact mechanism, like active research is going on. This is a current topic. So it is not, right now it is not clear what exactly the T1 transporter does. What is believed, is what has been accepted till now, is it is acting as a glucose 6-phosphate transporter, T1. But it has been hypothesized that T1 transporter has got so many other functions which are not being clear. Those functions, probably they are the ones which are involved in function of neutrophils. Means the function, main function of neutrophil in fighting against bacteria and in the bleeding, arrest of the bleeding and all that, it may be something to do with the T1, normal functioning T1 transporter. When the T1 transporter is down here, so along with increasing the glucose 6-phosphate, it is also affecting overall function of neutrophils, and that is why neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction is seen in von Goetz disease, type 1B disease. So in type 1A disease, all these signs and symptoms you see, whereas in type 1B, let me write it down, in type 1B, you are additionally you see neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction. Neutropenia and neutrophil dysfunction. This is for type 1B disease along with all these signs. So this is all about von Goetz disease type 1A and type 1B. Thanks for watching.